So I'll be discussing on overview on disaster mitigation and management. So it's a very big field, like it's a very vast field. It's not like other, you know, science subject. It's one of the very vast field. It involves a lot of engineering, science, as well as arts. Everything is combinedly. We call it as disaster management. I'll be just giving the overview on disaster management, particularly about different disasters and why this disaster management subject is very important. Disaster mitigation and management subject is important to an administrative officer, particularly where is your role is very, very important. I'll just give, you know, the first half, I'll just brief something, introduction and basics and other things. Second half, I'll tell you like how to effectively use this subject in your service, right? I'll just start with some basics, right? This is the top 10 disasters in the world from, you know, in the history. The first one is Alappey earthquake in 1138, 2.3 lakhs people died. And Sanchai earthquake in 1556, 8.3 lakhs people died. Kaifeng flood 1642, again 6 lakhs people died. Indian cyclone 1839, 3 lakhs people died. The flu pandemic in 1918-1919, 3.5 to 7.5 lakhs people died. Bola cyclone again in 1970, 10 lakhs people died. Dam failure in Bongai, China, 2.31 lakhs people died. Tangshan earthquake, 1976, 2.42 lakhs people died. African drought in 1981, again, about 20,000 people died. This is latest, 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami, about 2.3 lakhs people died. So if you see, like, you know, why I'm putting this slide, the deaths, like, you know, if you see all our, you know, more than a lakh actually, almost, right? In those days, we have a lot of human loss, right? So now our focus is to reduce this loss of lives due to these disasters. That's what our main focus. And I'll just show some of the pics of these earthquakes. This is Alappey, and this is Indian Ocean. This is dam failure. Tangshan again. Yeah. So that is all over the world. We have, you know, top disasters in India also. Kashmir flood in 2014, 500 plus death. Uttarakhand flood again, 5,000 people died. Indian Ocean tsunami, more than 2 lakhs people. Gujarat earthquake again, 20,000 people died. Odisha super cyclone, 10,000 people died. Lathur earthquake, 20,000 people died. This great famine in 1876, 1878. 3 crore plus death. So it's very alarming, right? But it is not shown in the history, right? In the worldwide. But when you come to India, we people talk about the famine. But now, if I think many of us know, you know, we may not know the name famine, right? It's not there right now. Totally, the famine is eradicated. You know what is meant by famine? It's because of lack of food, malnutrition, right? It's a kind of drought situation. Because of that, people, they die. So huge area got affected, right? So other disasters are directly affecting. This is a very slow disaster. So it's a long also. So it continues for a few years, 2 to 3 years. Because of that, a lot of people die. Okay, and this is our Kashmir flood. This is in 2013, Uttarakhand flood. The tsunami, 2004. Gujarat earthquake. This is Orissa super cyclone. Orissa super cyclone, again, we have a lot of cyclones, but we always remember Orissa super cyclone. Because this is in 1999, somewhere 10,000 people died that time itself. And more than 2,75,000 people got homeless. But now if you go to Orissa, the death toll will be 1 or less than 1. Even, see, there is no death toll now, nowadays in Orissa. Orissa is the best example in India for disaster management activities, particularly on disaster management plans. So there is a role model for whole India. So few states in India, we you know, really work on disasters. So Orissa is on Ramangan, we can say it's Orissa is top in that. Okay. And this is Latur earthquake. This what the Great Famine. This is Koringa cyclone in 1839, 3.2 lakhs people died. Calcutta cyclone 1739, 7. Bengal Famine again, two times. Okay. So this is a definition for disaster by the UNISDR. You know what is the UNISDR? United Nations International Strategy for Disaster Reduction, Risk Reduction. Okay. So what they told, the impact of a natural or man-made event upon a vulnerable community resulting in disruption, damage and casualties which cannot be relieved by the unaided capacity of locally mobilized resources. We have so much definitions for disasters, but this is the, you know, the correct definition for disaster by UNISDR. What they mean here is which cannot be relieved by the unaided capacity of locally mobilized resources. If it is not, you know, by us, when we are calling assistance from the neighboring state or neighboring country, then only we will call it as a disaster, right? So, what is disaster management? Disaster management is applied science which seeks by the systematic observation and analysis of disasters to improve measures relating to prevention, mitigation, preparedness, emergency response and recovery. So, the efficient use of resources to coordinate process of relief, recovery and reconstruction. Why it is very, very important, particularly for an administrative point of view. So, if a state or a district or a country administrator is not able to understand or handle the disaster, he or she should be, you know, the responsible for the whole event. That's why whenever any disasters happen, even in Kerala flood or Chennai flood, the government of India or government of Tamil Nadu or government of Kerala, they don't say it's a disaster immediately. So if you immediately announce it's a disaster, then you should take the responsibility. It means like you are not able to handle the situation. A chief minister cannot able to handle the situation, then he should resign his job. So the administrator of the state should take the responsibility. That's why immediately we don't announce it's a disaster. So we always call it as a calamity. Calamity is not always a disaster. It's a different, right? It's but little bit, you know, closer terminology to your disaster. So they always announce this as a disaster for after some times. That too, they'll say like we are trying to, you know, handle the situation. We have handled partially. Okay. But if you want to handle further, we need fund, right? So that's why the disaster management fund will come in picture. So government of India has to release the, you know, National Disaster Management Fund, relief fund for the states, right? So it's a, you know, very, very important subject for all levels, actually. How naturals are, how are natural hazards? You need to understand before, you know, going into, you know, talk about any disasters, you need to understand what a disaster will do. That you need to understand. If you want to treat any disasters, so you are the people in future going to handle the disasters. So sometimes few disasters you can prevent. Few disasters you cannot prevent. Few disasters you can manageable, right? Some disaster can be, you know, handled in time. Some disasters you can give early warning systems. So few you cannot do. So you need to understand, then based on that only you can do the mitigation measures and management activities. Okay. So if an earthquake in a place there is no settlement, right? If the earthquake in a place there is no settlements or people or public, no infrastructure, there is not much harm, right? No much harm. So earthquake may be there. Ground will shake, but nobody will die, right? So, same earthquake in a built-up area, city. So, what happened? So, a lot of people may get injured. Loss of life may be possible. So, simply I can say like in this room, if there is a earthquake morning 6 o'clock, you all hear, right? Right? That time nobody won't be there, morning 6 o'clock, right? Only room will be there, building will shake, it may get partial collapse or fully collapse, but no loss of lives. The same earthquakes, right? Same earthquake may occur during this time, 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock. You all hear, if there is a building, you know, damage, obviously, there is a chances of loss of lives, there is a chances of, you know, damage, right, to particular. Then, earthquake may be same, time and place is very, very important, right. So, we are looking after mainly on this part, the vulnerable. So, when there is an earthquake happen, nobody is not there, we call it as a hazard, like in this room, for example. If few people are there, when there is an earthquake, what we will do? The earthquake is minor, maybe a tremor, 3 magnitude or 3.5 magnitude, there will be only a shaking. You have doors, you can go out, okay, you can try to evacuate. Is it possible? Very much possible, right? Or if the earthquake is mitigatable, somewhat, we can go for some earthquake resistant design. If the building is quite enough for earthquake resistant design, you don't need to worry. Earthquake will be there, building will shake, but building won't collapse. So, you need to know what to do during a earthquake, right? So, that is more than sufficient. So, that's what our main focus is. Either it can be mitigatable or it should be manageable. So, how to do that, right? Okay. So, for that you need to understand about the disasters first. Some of the disasters are rapid onset and slow onset. Rapid onset in the sense like, you know, earthquakes. The onset may be in seconds, right? It may happen within seconds. So, that's why we can't able to give any early warning for earthquakes. But in case of a flood or a cyclone, now we have very good early warning system for flood and cyclone, right? So, we can give early warning for 74 hours, 48 hours. Very good early warning we can give, right? Because the onset of the disaster will give a time. So, I can clearly say nowadays the technology has developed. So, tomorrow, you know, maybe after 2 days or 3 days, the cyclone is going to hit you. So, that's why Orissa is very good in, you know, disaster management. They track the cyclone nicely with the help of IMD and they have their own system, right? But they prepare for that. They have a time for 3 days time is there or 2 days time is there. So, you can easily prepare for a disaster like cyclone or a flood. But in case of an earthquake, it is not possible. Why? Predictability. See, what is meant by prediction? See, nowadays, everybody, they use the word called prediction, right? So, if somebody from computer science background, they use in deep learning or machine learning or big data analysis, they call prediction. That prediction is different. This prediction is different. That's what I told, the time, including time, is very, very important. Prediction in earthquakes, you need a lot of accuracy. Right, say example, if I say there's going to be an earthquake, you are all IAS officer, right? So, assume you are the collector of the district. If I say, okay, tomorrow there'll be an earthquake, what you'll do? That is for cyclone, it is okay. In case of earthquake, what you'll do? Is that similar way you can evacuate people for a cyclone or an earthquake? No. Yes. So, the first question already raised, what is the magnitude of the earthquake, right? Say, if I say tomorrow there is going to be only 3 magnitude earthquake, you are a IAS officer, because evacuation is not an easy task. So, Chennai city, 53 lakhs people are there within city, I am telling, 170 square kilometer area, about 53 lakhs people are there. How will you evacuate all 53 lakhs people? It's a big task. If there is going to be only 3 magnitude earthquake, there is no need of evacuating all 53 lakhs people. Because I am going to use public money, all taxpayers, right? Right? Why should I evacuate all 53 lakhs people? So, first thing is, your epicenter play a major role in earthquake. So, you can't, without knowing the earthquake magnitude, you can't evacuate. If you do that, then it will be a failure model. That's what happened when one guy, he told like he is going to trace the earthquake in Assam. This has happened. He's my friend only actually. He's not really a geologist, but he do some, you know, astrological things. He said, I predicted earthquake, but ultimately earthquake has not happened in India. So simply I say, like, it happened 20 centimeter away. 20 centimeter away is a huge difference in a, you know, 1:6 million scale or 1:5 million scale map, right? 1:1 million scale is how much? 1 kilometer equal to 10 kilometer or 100 kilometer. 10 kilometer, right? 1 centimeter equal to 10 kilometer. 20 centimeter equal to 200 kilometer. So if I put a point in Assam, 200 kilometer, it will go to Bangkok, right? Thailand. So his prediction, he said, like, you know, so it's just 20 centimeter away. What is the use of prediction then? No use. So he said, from Assam, 20 centimeter accuracy. But ultimately, it has hit in somewhere in Burma or some other place. Okay. He said 6 magnitude. Ultimately, only 2.3 magnitude happened. That too, not because of his prediction. But some other movement. So it's a wrong prediction. So prediction in the sense, if I say tomorrow 4 o'clock in Shankar IAS Academy, 4th Avenue, in this building, this is the epicenter of the building, so you are going to have 6.5 magnitude earthquake. Why I am telling all those things? Accuracy of earthquake is very, very important, because each and every point magnitude will have a difference. A 3 magnitude and 4 magnitude will have a 300 times difference. 4 and 5 will have a 1000 times difference. 5 and 6 again 10,000. Like that, in it will multiply in thousands when it going, you know, above. So you can't say, right? You can't say, like, you know, exactly what is the magnitude of. So the time of onset is play a major role in, because why I'm again telling, people, they don't understand public, you know. So this has happened in recently in Ambur, there was an earthquake, small tremor. It is not even an earthquake. I'll tell you detail about it later. So almost whole village people, they came. They are not going back to their home for one full day. So I went there, I explained everything. Collector came, DRO came, RDO came, but they are not able to convince people. People, what they say? Simply, whether earthquake will come or not again. How will you predict earthquake? So this kind of situation you may get in future if you are posted as a collector or a DRO or whatever may be. You need to be careful to handle the people during that time. So you need to know what happened exactly, right? So that is one case. Another one, controllable event and immutable events. Because again, so people, lot of people, they used to simply, you know, question during disasters. Oh, this can be possible to stop. This cannot possible to stop. So that's why, you know, always whenever we open the TV, right, there is argument going on. So any disaster, say this particularly the Borwell disaster, right, which has happened during Diwali time. Everybody, they talk about government. Government did an excellent, you know, operation during that time. But ultimately, 90% of the people, they blame government. Right? Is it? Right? So because they do not know what is in the ground reality. Right? So what can be done? People, they do not know. Simply, they aggravate the issues. Right? So controllable events and immutable events. Few events we can control. For example, a landslide. So nowadays technology has come. We can control the landslide. We can stabilize the slope so that landslide cannot happen in future. So we have so much techniques. I'll show you some of the techniques, like what we are using right now in India. So that kind of events are, disasters are there. And immutable events, you can, some of the events you can immute. So it may not come hereafter. You can do that, right? And frequency versus severity, right? This also play a major role. So when you are allocating fund, right, for a district, for a state, so what they do generally, fund allocation mainly for whichever is high priority. So if I say, you know, if you want earthquake monitoring system for Tamil Nadu, okay, for example. So Chief Minister will immediately ask how many earthquakes happened in last 20 years. Do you remember anything? I'm just asking you a question. No, right? But it will happen, right? It may happen 50 years or 100 years once or 200 years, because earthquake return period may be 200 years once or 100 years once. So when you say 100 years once or 200 years once, immediately they'll ask a question. It is not going to happen next 10 years or 20 years. Why I need to monitor? Because it's a common man question. So why I need to invest so much money on earthquakes? Instead of spending earthquake monitoring system for 1 crore rupees, I can spend that 1 crore rupees to education. Right? I can renovate all the school buildings. That's what an IAS officer thinks. Right? So, but it is not in the case. Like, you know, most of the disasters like earthquakes, frequency may not be there. It may happen in 100 years once. But the damage due to the earthquake, it costs more. The severity is very high. Right? For example, frequency of flood every year will be there. But that much damage it won't create. But one day, one time earthquake, like that's what I told in Bhuj. You know, whole state is shattered. So almost, you know, lot of loss of lives, everything has happened. Right? So one earthquake. So whole thing, like, you know, whatever you talk about last 20 years, you have to come back, like, you know, to the normal. It will take a lot of time, right? Whatever you spend money for other activities, you have to spend here in disaster, right? So this is one thing, and mitigation measures to withstand the impact and mitigation measures to avoid the impact. So what is mitigation measures? If you are trying to mitigate the disasters, whatever you are going to do, take, right? For example, nowadays, like, a lot of very good things are happening in Tamil Nadu, like flood mitigation is happening. Drought mitigation. So Tamil Nadu is very good for drought mitigation. People, they have done very nicely. Somehow we are managing droughts. Flood also, like, you know, most of the district collectors are very good. They are doing this flood, you know, flood mitigation plan. So some mitigation measures, if you do, it can withstand. For example, if you construct the building earthquake resistant, okay, then you can withstand the earthquake force. Again, all these things why I'm telling. You are an IAS officer, you should know. Suppose I am in Chennai. Okay. Earthquake resistant building is required to Chennai or not. If you are posted in Gujarat, earthquake resistant design, you know, needed in Gujarat or not. You should know. Right. Chennai in zone 3, Gujarat in zone 5, right. Delhi in zone 4. So which zone, what you have to do? That also very important. Like, you know, every place you don't need to go for a mitigation measures to withstand. It's not required, right? Because each and everything involves a lot of money. So that's why government always, you know, focus on this kind of disaster management, because you are going to get a lot of money as well as you are going to spend a lot of money in disaster. Okay. And avoid impact. So a lot of, you know, new things again, like landslides. So you can avoid totally a landslide. You can avoid totally a flood prone area from a flood. That can be possible nowadays. And the nature of the study area. So a disaster in village is different. A disaster in a city is different. The impact is totally different from a city and a village. Right? So again, for example, always we always say Chennai flood has happened. Right? Which is the most affected part of Tamil Nadu during Chennai flood? Kadalur. You know that? Kadalur is the most affected. But we don't, you know, none of the papers or none of the, you know, reports shown Kadalur is most affected. Why? This is headquarters. Chennai is headquarters. All TV, media, everybody, they shown only Chennai. But Kadalur is most affected compared to Chennai. So study area is very, very important, because here you have huge population. But in case of damage, of course, Kadalur is most affected. Only people affected more is in Chennai. There is a lot of difference, right? So that also very, very important when you are doing your, you know, assessment for a disaster in a district level or a state level. So whom you have to concentrate. Okay. Purpose. Why we need to study this subject, disaster management. So you need to understand what a disaster will do. Right? Many people, they do not understand this. So unless you know what a disaster will do, you can't able to do the mitigation measures or any management activity. It is not possible. And the general effects, characteristics of various types of disaster. What each and every disaster, it has its own characteristics. An earthquake, people, they think that if there is a, you know, a bigger magnitude earthquake, ground will open, all will go inside. It is not going to happen at any case. That's a plate tectonic theory. That's a different. So even for 8 magnitude or 9 magnitude, ground will not open, all will not go inside. People, they misguide us in cinemas. It is not going to happen. It's a shaking of a ground. Right? And earthquake will have a different characteristics. Landslide will have a different characteristics. Flood will have a different characteristics. Yeah, flood will have a different characteristics. A cloud burst will have a different characteristics. So each and everything, the classification is very, very important to understand the disaster, right? And general countermeasures and special problem areas. So what you can do for that? So you are posted in some place. So I always link with what you are going to do in your administrative service. You are posted in some place. How effectively use your knowledge of this disaster management into taking care of this mitigation part and management part. Because again, a lot of money involved. So you have to spend money. If I say, like, you know, I'm an expert in earthquakes, I can say you do earthquake resistant building all over Chennai. One building, if you want to do 3.2% of your total cost of the building. Say example, this building may be 1.2 crores. So 3.2% of this building is how much? So again, you have to add that money with that. So like that, we have lakhs and lakhs of building in Chennai. You can't do earthquake resistant design for all buildings. Money involved, right? People, they don't afford that much money. So you need to understand. So where you can concentrate on some special problematic areas, which are all the areas you can focus to minimize the damage. That's what you can do. Okay. And you know very well general effects, loss of lives, injury, damage to destruction to poverty, destruction to subsistence, cash crops, disruption to production, lifestyle, loss of livelihood, essential services will damage, national infrastructure disruption to governmental systems, national economic loss, sociological and psychological after effects. So these are all some of the general effects. So again, it's a huge field. Is one after one, it will come, right? It's not immediately, like immediately after a disaster, then there is a sequence of events, okay? So, important community needs, particularly the community always depends on government in case of a disaster particularly. So, that's why we always insist of community-based disaster management. The community-based disaster management insists mainly on, so, there is a time to take, like, you know, government cannot do everything immediately, right? So till that time, how you can handle yourself? That's what we call community-based disaster management. In that, we cover all those things, like, so we used to teach them what a disaster will do, the best immediate action to personally and families and kin groups. Here only we go for this first aid and other things. And how best to help other members of the community. So if you are safe, then how you can help to others, and what government has planned to assist the community, and how to participate effectively in disaster communication and warning process. That's what now we are using a lot of self-help groups to create awareness among the village level, and how to improvise the shelter and subsistence until the assistance is available. Because so with the, you know, based on the available material with us, so we used to provide the shelters. This is actually very, very important during major emergencies actually. So have you seen this actually? Right? How many of you know? How many of you know about disaster management system? Where it will start? Where it will start? I said relief. Somebody told relief. Preparedness. Mitigation planning. Risk reduction. Okay. It's a cycle, right? So I'll divide it into two. Okay, one is pre-disaster, right? This is pre-disaster, this is post-disaster, right? So pre-disasters, before, right? Before the events happen, and after the events happen, and we have something during also, right? So generally we, like people like India, right, we don't much bother about pre-disaster. That is a major thing happening all over the world. Like, you know, so people, they are very much aware about pre-disasters. But in case of India, we are not much aware of pre-disasters. That's why a lot of training programs, so all those things at government level. So P2P, we are giving training. So from, you know, Prime Minister office to Pune, we are giving, you know, training on disaster management. Even for engineering colleges, schools, we are introduced disaster management as a subject, right? So what we do immediately after the disaster, the first thing is rescue, right? So how many of you know what is meant by rescue? NDRF. Somebody says rescue means NDRF. It is not your job then, right? No, that's what I'm asking. It's correct. NDRF is correct. So that's what. So you need to understand clearly what is rescue. So rescue is saving lives. Who's the rescuer? The first responder. Who's the first responder? You are the first responder, right? You may be an IAS officer, or you may be a, you know, individual capacity, you may be a teacher, anything. But for example, if he is going to collapse, he is the first responder, right? So who are all the people nearby him is the first responder. Again, rescuing for an accident is different. Rescuing for a disaster is a different. So I was there in Nepal earthquake, actually. During, immediately after the Nepal earthquake, we went for, you know, all this rescue operation and other things with the help of military people, the local, you know, NGO people, all these things. It's a different scenario. Here, you know, you might have heard about Mauli Akam incident, right? How many of you know Mauli Akam building collapse, right? 1, 2, 3, okay. So the event which has happened in the evening time, right? It's only a building collapse, okay? Because of the foundation failure, building has collapsed. So how to rescue these people who got trapped inside, right? So simply he said, like, you know, you call NDRF, they will come and do. Where is NDRF? In Tamil Nadu, where it is located. Anybody knows? Near Vellore, Arakkonam. How much time it will take to come to Chennai? Minimum 2 hours. So this is what happened. So we have fire and rescue services. So earlier it was fire services. Now it is fire, rescue and search, right? So now they renamed. So they are trained now. Earlier it was not like that. Only fire service. Fire service people, they are trained only for fire related disasters. Okay, if there is a fire in a building, what they do? They come and quench the fire. They will go. If there is a person who got injured by fire, they know how to handle them. A person who got injured by a building damage, he cannot. That was the situation in, you know, in India once upon a time. Now people are trained, actually. So rescue, a building collapse, is totally different from a normal fire accident, right? So how? For example, a building like this. So that building is 11 floor building. We have a car parking, say a soft story. That is called soft story. In the bottom, we have a car parking, similar kind of building, right? So people are under the basement. That is on the Friday. People supposed to get their, you know, daily, weekly money, right? Wage. Okay, so they went to the downside of the basement of the building. So half of the people got trapped inside. Half of the people, they died, right? So ultimately, based on that event, we rescued only 27 people. Around 60 people died during that time. So when event was happened, it was evening time, late evening. By the time NDRF reached, it's night. So night time, you can't do the operation, rescue operation. Very difficult. Building is buckled, so we call pancake collapse. Pancake collapse is if the floors fall one over the other. That's called pancake collapse. That's what happened in Gujarat, Bhuj earthquakes. Most of the buildings. So it's rarely getting people lives inside because ceiling will come down. The chances of death is very high. Right? It's one over the other. So it's collapsed like this. What people do? They generally go and do the search and rescue operation in this part because they think people are there here. But it is not the case. People are in the basement. So removing the debris itself taking a lot of time. That's why a lot of people died during that event. So unless you know how to rescue, how to search in a building collapse, you can't save the lives, as many lives as possible. So that is the major things in rescue operation you need to have. And the second thing, like, you know, that time, our former Chief Minister Jalalda was there, district collector was there, Adivo, Tasuldar, all IA, you know, some four or five ministers, everybody, they came. So during that time, almost 700 people at the site. So we are able to rescue only 27 people. To rescue 27 people, the manpower we used is 700. Think if there is an earthquake in Chennai. 53 lakhs people are there in Chennai. Within Chennai city, not, metro. Within the old Chennai city boundary itself, 170 square kilometer, we have, 28,000 people per square kilometer area. So how much manpower you require to rescue? It's a big event, right? This is an only small event where you have only building collapse. If there is an earthquake, how much we prepared? You need to understand, right? So that is rescue. So once rescue is over, then we'll go for a relief operation. So there you'll play a major, there'll be a major challenge in relief operation. So relief in the sense like, you are going to get huge number of material is going to come. How to handle, right? During Chennai flood, we get a lot of water, drinking water, right? From other part, right? It came in ships. I think anybody know about this? Okay, off the record, I'll tell you what happened, right? Drinking water came in a container in ships. Ultimately, we don't have a system to transfer this water to our ground. Because everywhere you have flood, there is no storage point. How to transfer this water from ship to road is a major issue. We don't have such a big tankers in Tamil Nadu during that time. Ultimately, what we did, asked them to wait for 2 days. They said, if they are going to wait this, in the ship for another 2 days, the ship will sink because the weight of the container is huge. Ultimately, what they did, they removed the total drinking water into sea. This has happened in our Tamil Nadu, in our Chennai city, during Chennai flood. We don't have a system, right? In Nepal earthquakes, huge number of relief material came. So when I was actually, I reached the third day after Nepal earthquake. So one tanker lorry full of medicine came. Medicine. So we have a doctor team. Send the doctor team to segregate the medicine. Everybody said I can't able. Why? Because all in German language. This medicines are in German language. How will you read and segregate? Ultimately, we use technology during that time. We asked some of the computer science students of Nepal to create an app so that app can read. It will convert automatically German language into English, translating. So there is a creation lab. People, they did it. So ultimately, they are able to transfer. And a lot of material came, relief material, and they don't have a storage place in Nepal. Same thing happened in Chennai flood also. You might have heard about people are very generous during, flood. Any disaster time, particularly in Tamil Nadu, lot of people, they are generous to give lot of materials. But ultimately, people, they are not using. So in our, particularly in Tamil Nadu, first day, they'll ask for food, right? So So what people they do generally, our people are very generous. They send dosa. They send, you know, lemon rice, tamarind rice, all those things. That's what we generally do. You know, I used to go to a lot of, you know, foreign universities, Philippines particularly. Whenever I go to Philippines, like, you know, any corner of the building, there'll be some food packets, like, you know, small packages. I used to ask, whatever the university I go, in any auditorium, in the corner of the auditorium, you can see some kind of food packets. And I ask them, right, everywhere it is there, why? They say, like, you know, every time, anytime they have flood and cyclone, water will come in. So we take this food, it's like noodles. They will put it in water, they will eat. That is the thing they are doing, because they frequently affected by flood and cyclone. They know how to handle the situation. But in case of us, we do dosa. Dosa, you know, preparation of dosa. How much time it will take? You need to have a rice, right? Ultam parpu. 3 hours you have to make it wet, minimum 3 hours. Then you have to grind it. Then you have to make dosa. But if dosa is chilled, then nobody will eat, right? But people, they are very generous. They are sending dosas. So it is not required, actually. During emergency, it is not required. People in case of our, you know, Tamil Nadu, like, we are very generous. People, they used to send a lot of dosas and particularly lemon rice. Lemon rice, you know, maybe after 3 hours or 4 hours is getting smell. So what people, they do, all this material, they'll put it in the roadside. Okay. So it's a major issue during disasters, you know, distributing relief as well as, you know, the getting relief material. So it's a huge area again. Only for that itself, you have some, you know, there's a separate book to handle how to relieve. It is there. Separate book is there. So one full book, if you read, like, it takes some minimum 6 to 7 months to complete that courses. It's a huge area. So relief is a major problem during disasters. After relief, rehabilitation. So people, you have to get rehabilitated to people. So mainly, a lot of people, they'll get, you know, jobless. Particularly, you would have heard about Thane cyclone, right? During Thane cyclone, all these places near Kadalur, Neyveli, Panruti, this side, a lot of people get affected by cyclone. So the main issues in that particular area is more of, you know, people, they work on cashews. You know, if you see, when you go Panruti, Neyveli, along the road, like, people, they sell cashews. So cashew plantation totally gone because of the cyclone. Ultimately, what happened? They had, you know, lose their job. You know, what is the specialty in cashews? You know, cashew will be now. If you want to regrow a cashew, it will take minimum 1 year. So government gives subsidy only for cashew plantation. Say 10 trees, if I have 10 trees, I can calculate each tree 10,000 rupees, 1 lakh rupees is okay. But if I want to get the cashew from the tree, minimum I have to wait 1 year, one complete year. So till that time, what happened to my family? So there is no, you know, scheme or no, you know, plan in our, you know, country, particularly in Tamil Nadu, there is no plan. So how these people will get their job till 1 year, because they don't know any other job. So they'll get mentally affected. So these people get a lot of stress. So you have to rehabilitate the people. The lifestyle is very, very, you know, tough. You know, even in 2004 tsunami. Actually, I went for assessment. There is a place called Chadruas near, you know, Mahabalipuram, Chadrangapatnam. So I went for assessment around in the year 2007 or 2008. After 4 years, United Nations Development Program, they want to do assessment how people are happily living after tsunami. That was the study. When I enter in a house, call people, like, you know, 6-7 ladies were there. I called all 7 ladies. We were talking. So whether you remember 2004 tsunami, this is the question I asked. Those ladies, no? they called me and they took me to the another room. Actually, the same house, there is another room. They closed the door, they started crying. I was shocked because all seven ladies, I'm the only guy inside the room. They are crying. And I said, why? Then they said, all these seven ladies' husbands, they died during tsunami. That time there is no place. They buried all the seven women's husband's dead body in the same room. They are living in the same room. So how people, they, you know, during the tsunami. So rehabilitating those kind of people is very, very difficult. And we conducted a lot of painting competition for school kids. So almost all the kids, they painted, like they put a water inside, there is some kids picture. I asked them, you all copied? They said, no, we are not copied. This is my sister, this is my brother, like that they told. So those kids, brother and sister, they died during tsunami. They have witnessed. So rehabilitating these people is a major challenge. Even in Tamil, not only in Tamil Nadu, all over India, it is not a successful story. Still it is going on. So many disasters like Kumbakonam tragedy. Still people are, they are not rehabilitated. Still their family. So all this 2004 tsunami, all these families, till they are not getting their proper, you know, rehabilitation things. It's a major area. You should rehabilitate the people life. And reconstruction. You need to reconstruct the life of the people after disaster. Like many people, you know, in India, what we do, like, you know, we give a lot of money for reconstruction. Say, if my house is gone, what we do, we'll give house. Right? This is a major problem which has happened during tsunami. Simply, they give boats. For example, fishermen. So, government, they give a lot of boats to people who lost their boats during 2004 tsunami. What happened? No? There is no coordination between the NGOs. And see, every NGOs, that time, a lot of international NGOs came in picture. They distributed boats. A lot of boats. See, I am in a family. In my family, I have five members, for example. So, I am only the fisherman. All this, my brothers and sisters, they are not a fisherman. But what these people will do, sir, I am also a fisherman. So, each family, they will get five boats. You know, each family, they get five boats. And they cheat. They cheat, they get five boats. Again, they say, like, you know, one NGO will give five boats, another NGO will give another two boats, totally seven boats. So there is no proper coordination. This is the major area in reconstruction we are facing during disasters. Even government facing a lot of disasters. We need to streamline. So this may happen because disaster is nothing but money. So a lot of money will pour during disaster. People, they are ready to give money. But if you are not properly allocating the money during that time, it's a major issue. And reconstruction again, we do a lot of nice reconstruction activity for the public. For example, 2004 tsunami, there is a, you know, World Bank project. They constructed very nice houses. Government of Tamil Nadu with the World Bank, they did a very nice houses by following, you know, coastal regulations. So ultimately, when we went for assessment, none of the fishermen, they didn't stay in the house. Why? You know why? Actually, fishermen's houses, they constructed 3 kilometers away. So when we went, first thing, he took me. Actually, one fisherman, he took me. Sir, please come with me. I said, like, okay, come. We'll go and see, like, he showed one toilet. It's a Western type toilet. He said, like, I don't know how to use it. Then we realized, because fund is from World Bank, the architect is from France, Italy. They do not know what is the kind of people here in India, in Tamil Nadu, in fishermen. They simply construct a house with a Western type toilet. How people will use? They are using, they just close, they use that room for some other purpose. And most of the people, they are not living. And we asked, they said, sir, this is 3 kilometers away from the sea. So I want to go for fishing by morning 3 o'clock. By the time I reach 3 o'clock, when I woke, I reach, seashore, it will take minimum half an hour to 1 hour. My whole energy will go down. So how will I go and do the fishing? I can go and do, but how I can bring my boats? I cannot put my boat over there in the sea, near seashore, and stay some 3 kilometers away. It's a fisherman problem. So many issues are there. Because they are all living near the seashore. They want to go for fishing at early morning. So all these problems will raise. So when you are reconstructing the lifestyle of any people, you need to say same thing happened in Bhuj earthquake. So 2001 Bhuj earthquake, when we visited, morning, lot of nice relief material given by the government. They all give nice t-shirt, cargoes, all these things in Gujarat. So when we went for assessment in the evening time, these people, they put everything in the roadside. Then I called one fellow, say, this is very nice cargoes, t-shirt, it's in dollars, all in dollars. I said, sir, Sarji, you know what is the climate in Gujarat? I said, no, it's very, very hot in daytime. It's very cold in night time. We used to have a long dhoti. So we used to wear that and work in a, you know, farm. Then night time, the same thing we used to use as a bed sheet and sleep. This is a common man problem. We don't understand. We give nice jeans and t-shirt. They don't want. It may be, you know, for, you know, 1,000 rupees, 2,000. They don't want. They want simply a dhoti. Another big issue in Tamil Nadu, like we face, we give lot of nighty. Without nighties, our ladies can't able to live here in Tamil Nadu. And another biggest problem during Chennai flood, we give nighties, but they want innerwear. Without innerwear, they can't wear nighty. This is another major problem in Tamil Nadu. So it may be, maybe people may laugh. We face this problem. Sir, you are giving only nighty. So we don't think, right now, guys, we don't think generally. So do the relief operation. This has happened. So many issues are there in, so you need to understand what is their real need. Unless you do this properly, your whole process will fail you. And then what we will do after reconstruction? We'll go for election, right? That's what happened. So we don't do this risk reduction part, all those things. So we'll have election, we'll go for voting. So people who are all giving money will vote. That's what happened, right? So I always quote this one everywhere, like wherever I go, because this is happening in all developing countries, not only in Tamil Nadu, not only in India, it's happening everywhere, in Philippines, Indonesia, all Asian countries particularly this is happening. The main issue is, like, you need to go for the risk reduction. So what is risk reduction? It's reducing the risk of the life. So that's why, have you heard about this Hyogo framework and Sendai framework? You might have heard, right? How many of you know? What is the difference, Hyogo and Sendai? What is the difference, Hyogo and Sendai? Hyogo framework is mainly based on managing the disasters. That is till 2015, right? So during those times, we focus only on manage the disaster. Now, we are focusing the Sendai framework. We are mainly focusing on disaster risk reduction. So we have to reduce the risk. That's what our main mandate is. That's what risk reduction is, nothing but hazard and vulnerability assessment. You need to know. So I told, like, you know, in this room, nobody is not there. It's a hazard. If everyone is there, then there is an earthquake. It's called, you know. So during that time, you people are the vulnerable community. If you know how to evacuate, if you know how to manage, then the death will be zero. Right? Hazard will be there always. Earthquake will be there, landslide will be there, cyclone will be there. Say, Chennai is a place, for example. Tamil Nadu is a place, an area. In that area, hazards will be there. Always the population vulnerability is same, right? But in case of earthquake, the scenario is different. In case of a landslide, scenario is different. In case of a cyclone, the scenario is different. Again, everything is based on the magnitude of the event. Right? So that's what we mainly focus on. How to reduce the risk by doing, you know, vulnerability and hazard assessment. Hazard will be there. If the vulnerability is zero, hazard into vulnerability with capacity, it is nothing but your risk. Right? So if you have hazard, there is no vulnerability. If you know how to handle, if you have a capacity, then it will become zero. Zero into zero, the risk will be zero. So that's what our main focus. Why this subject is very, very, because that's what I took a lot of time to explain on this one slide. I have another 300 slides, but so I mainly focus. This is very important. So people, we are mainly focusing on risk reduction. So we are going to reduce the life of the, you know, risk of the life of the people. Okay. How to do that? You can do based on the mitigation planning and preparedness. So these two areas are very, very important. Why this is important again? If you are spending, you know, money on this rescue, relief, rehabilitation, reconstruction, for example, 1/3 of the money only you need to spend for this. So ultimately, your 1/3 of money, if you spend over here, then you can save another 3 parts. So that's what our main focus on disaster. So the another thing is you need to continue the cycle. So you need to know what has happened. Then only the cycle will be completed. So that's what during 2004 tsunami, we do not know about much about tsunami. Only geologists know what is tsunami. We handle the situation, right? Then after that 2011, we came to know. Then 2014, so slowly, 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 we understand what is disaster. So now somewhat our focus is on disaster. So the loss of lives is keep on reducing. For example, Chennai flood. After that, there is a flood, but we manage it. After that, there is a cyclone, we managed. So nicely, our government, they're doing, you know, things. So that's why the government of Tamil Nadu, the government of India and government of Tamil Nadu insists the district disaster management authority is focused on every district to have a district disaster plan, right? So I'll tell you how to prepare a district disaster plan later. Okay, so it is there in the, okay, that's what I told, like, you know, you need to have more people to rescue. And another challenge is, you know, doing rescue in the night time. And clearance and access during major disaster is a major issue. So you don't get a road access, you need to have a problem. And evacuation is the major issue. Shelter. So during major disaster, see nowadays, like, you know, it's very good. Like whenever there is a flood, what we do, we'll give leave for schools, then schools as a shelter. That's what we are using. But in case of earthquakes, you can't do that. Right, you need to have a proper shelter for earthquakes. It's not like a, you know, flood situation or cyclone situation. We have a cyclone shelters. Most of the schools are converted as a cyclone shelters during emergency. Nearby shelters we are using. But in case of earthquake, the schools may get damaged. You can't use your school as a, you know, shelter. You need to go for a temporary shelters. And this is another major problem, management of human bodies. During major disasters, you are going to get a lot of dead bodies. So I faced the problem, similar kind of problem in Malin. So there is a, anybody from Pune here? So there is a landslide in Malin, Malinga. Malinga was a village in Pune. So the landslide which is happening in early morning, 3 o'clock, whole village got washed away. Somewhere around 290 people died. One landslide, 290 people died. So during that time, you know, they don't have a tagging system because half of the people from the same village, but we don't have a, you know, record where are the other people are come. The whole village, total village population is only 170, but total dead bodies we found is 290. So where are the other people? So it's a major issue. They do not know. Dead bodies, it is not easy to identify. Because of the landslide, whole soil came and dead bodies came, you know, went inside. Head is splintered like that. Most of the people, they don't have hands. So it's very difficult to identify the person. These people, they came from other city to, you know, do the, you know, harvesting. What is that? Paddy cultivation. So paddy harvesting. It's the final day of paddy harvesting. So another 115 people from other village came. Later only we can able to identify some of the bodies. So that time, it's very difficult to handle the body. We put them in the, you know, next to the roadside and this state of a bury. So it's a major issue in disaster. And that's what I told, handling food for thousands of people, treatment and care of victims, health and sanitation is the major issue in disasters. So you need to much focus and communication. Communication is very, very important. So now India is doing very good in communication. I still remember during 2015 flood, a lady called me by evening 6 o'clock. You know, she told, like, I don't know who's that lady. I'm sitting in. So we used to have a, you know, technology, like, you know, use of social media and space technology for, you know, saving people. We do a lot of, you know, research on that. So sitting over there in Vellore, I can, you know, analyze what is happening all over the world. So using remote sensing and GIS, satellite data, all these things. During that time, one lady called me, 6 o'clock. She said, like, you know, my brother is missing. So we want, what is the clue, right? You know, we just asked her, what happened? She said, like, he's from US. He came to India, to Hyderabad. From Hyderabad, he is coming by car. Last call we attended, it is in Bindi. He came by Innova car. Only these two clue, we got it. We have a lot of volunteers during that time. We have a Facebook group. Actually, I'm one of the admin of that group. So we do a lot of service with people, like, you know, during emergency, like Jallikattu, all these times. So our students are there. 60,000 students are there, our volunteers. They work during, we have a very structured organization, like, you know, Facebook, the New Face Society of Tamil Nadu. So that girl called me, my brother is missing. She told, but ultimately only two clues. She said, in our car, car number also she don't know, color of the car. That's what she told. Ultimately, we tried to catch the fellow. One of our volunteer lastly, he met, like, sir, we caught the fellow. But ultimately what happened? The phone got switched off. This fellow's phones got switched off. The person who came from US, his phone also switched off. He saved. He took him, then they took him to somebody, you know, nearby house, saved everybody, like, you know, rescued, no problem. But problem is, like, we don't have communication from that guy. This lady calling, keep on calling. From night 8 o'clock to morning 5 o'clock, because next day morning 6 o'clock only, our people, they send this guy to his home. Ultimately, they find a way, they took him by bike and dropped. But till that time, this lady, more than 170 calls, she called me. I am sitting in Vellore, she is somewhere in Chennai. Well, this communication missed. This is what people, they face a problem. Like, I assume, like, you know, during that time, like, if one case is like that, how many people have, you know, problem? Same thing happened in Nepal earthquake. So one of our Indian team, like Indian people, pilgrimage group, so around 15 people, they went to Nepal. So ultimately, before reaching Nepal, you know, they called a tourist spot. They called. This fellow is watching me, my post in Facebook. He asked, so my family is missing. 15 people in that family, all are missing. So we are trying to trap, right? Where they are, which is the last place they moved. Because during emergencies are very difficult. We are not police officers, right? We can't go there and do all the operations. By our volunteers from Nepal. So we are trying to do this. But ultimately, it took 3 days to communicate to the people. So the whole 3 days, how much torture this family will get. So people, they, you know, if you have a miss of communication, it's a very big issue. Now at least we get some kind of new technology, like, you know, Google Finder is there, Facebook Finder is there. At least if your SIM is activating during that time, at least they can say, like, you know, so you are, you know, communicated. Some communication will be there. And water and power supplies, that's what I told. It's a major problem during emergency, temporary subsistence. Security is the major issue. So that's what even in Chennai flood, it has happened. A lot of people, they complained about during Chennai flood. So group of people, they come with the snakes. They put the snakes in water. So people, what they do? Afraid of snakes, they went to top floor, then they go to ground floor and take everything. This has happened in Chennai, right? In many other places, this has happened. So simply they come with some snakes, put it in the water. Ultimately, people, they are afraid of snake. They go to top floor. So meanwhile, they took everything and they went. So this is many other places which has happened. And public information, we have to continuously, disaster welfare inquiry, public moral, and further, we can go for damage assessment. This is what the post-disaster activities. Okay, and damage assessment, maintenance of awareness level. So we need to organize a lot of programs, information channels, so networking of people, linking of libraries. Okay, so it's a basic, like, you know, so I told you, like, initially it's a vast field. Disaster management is a vast field. So if I divide it into three, the hazard, vulnerability and risk. So hazard, generally scientists, they do hazard assessment. Geology people, geomorphology people, people from hydrology or meteorology, so geography people, geophysics people, they work on more of hazard part. And vulnerability, generally structural engineering, civil engineering people, engineering assessment, engineers, they work on vulnerability part. The main issue is, like, you know, the conveying message. I show, like, you know, a lot of maps we prepare scientists, but ultimately it is not properly conveyed to the engineers. That is the major problem. Like, you know, when you see any master plan, so if you go and ask any master plan, like any urban planner, they don't know what is meant by hazard. Because these people will give kind of maps, but these people, they don't know how to use these maps. That is the major issue. Even for any administrative officer, people, they give a lot of reports. Say 300 page, 400 page reports. But ultimately, an IAS officer doesn't have a time to read all this. So simply, you know, I used to attend a lot of meetings, like, simply our CRA ask, Ganapathy, tell me, if this has happened, what I have to do. So if I go and tell all this hazard, vulnerability map, this, that, and that, he don't want. Because he want only result. He don't have time to listen everything. Right? But our people, they do not know how to convey the message. This is the major problem in, you know, particularly in our, you know, structure, disaster management structure. People, they work a lot of things. They do a lot of research, but they do not know how to convey properly how a map can be useful for, you know, vulnerability analysis. That people are not doing. And same thing, like, you know, this vulnerable engineers, they do a lot of, you know, designs and other things, but they do not know how to convey the message to the administrator. Say, whenever we go to any IAS officer, immediately he'll ask, right? So whether, if I say, like, we have to monitor earthquakes in Tamil Nadu. So immediate question, whether you can predict earthquake? If I say no, right? So immediately he'll ask, why should I spend 50 lakhs rupees instrument to a earthquake monitoring system? This is the first question any IAS officer will ask. So I have to convince, sir, if we have to monitor, then only we can able to do some analysis. Based on the analysis, these are all the things we can do. Like that, if I convince, then it is possible. So this is the major lack of problem in our country. Particularly, these people doesn't work together. Engineer have a fight with IAS officer. Engineer, the scientist will have a fight with the engineer. So they don't work together. And many other cases I used to see, doctors doesn't like IAS officer. Architects doesn't like engineer. Scientist doesn't like engineer. This is the problem in our country. I don't know why. So most of the cases, even SP doesn't, you know, cooperate with a collector. This is happening in many of the cases I used to see. So you need to work together. So wherever, whichever the districts, the SP and collector is, you know, closely working, then that district will be having a very good progress, I can tell you. Very good progress. This is a major problem raises in our, particularly in our, they are not, because they are in equal cadre, IAS and IPS equal cadre, so they don't go. So it should not be, right? So that's why it's the main issue. Disaster management in India, we have, you know, only 2% of the land mass, and we have 16% of the population. So that is the one reason where we have, say, example, in this room, all these chairs are filled, right? Maybe around 300 people can sit over there, or 200 people can sit over. So now only, you know, maybe around 60 to 70 people are there, right? The place is same, but the vulnerability is less now, right? If all, you know, 200 people are sitting in this room, the vulnerability is high, right? So only if now, if something happened, everyone can easily evacuate, right? If the whole room got filled, then only half of the people can easily evacuate. Few people can trap inside. So the vulnerability of any place is depending on the number of people. So that's why in India, we have a small area, but you have a huge, the density of population is huge. So that's the major problem in India. So every country, they have a classification of disasters. In our country, we have our own classification. India have our own classification. We have our Prime Minister formulated high powered committee. Prime Minister formulated in the sense this is there for long. Like, you know, not like Narendra Modi, not like Manmohan Singh. It is there for a long. Okay. So this is called high powered committee. This committee group disaster into five major groups. Okay. You don't need to take notes. I'll give you the PPT. You can use it. Okay. Whole PPT I'll copy if you want. I'll copy in the laptop. You can use it. Okay. So we have five major groups of, if you want any material, just mail me, then I'll share it. Okay. PPT is big file. You can take it from here in pen drive. And any disaster related material, I have a lot of books also. If you want, I'll share it. E-books are there. I can share it with you. Okay. And we have five major groups of disasters. One is water and climate related disasters. We have floods, cyclones, tornadoes, hailstorm, cloudburst, heat wave and cold wave, snow avalanches, droughts, sea erosion, thunder and lightning. And geology related disasters, landslide and mudflows, earthquakes, dam failures, mine fire and tsunami. And we have chemical, industrial and nuclear related disasters, and chemical and industrial related disasters, nuclear related disasters. And we have accident related disasters. Accident is not really a disaster. Okay. We don't consider generally accident as a disaster because it's happening by knowingly. Accident generally it's happen, you know, because of our mistake. But why we grouped in India accident also as a disaster? Every year lakhs of people they died because of the accident. So what government they thought like it is equivalent, somewhat equivalent to natural disasters. So they grouped all accidents under one group. Like you know, forest fire, urban fire, mine flooding, oil spill, major building collapse, bomb blast, festival disasters, electrical disaster, air, road, rail accident, boat capsizing. So village fire, everything is comes under accident related disasters under one group. And biological related disaster, it's a flood in mines. Actually what happened in underground mines, so many times, you know, there'll be a flooding. Okay, that's what happened in Thailand also recently. So when you get, you know, flood inside the mine, so like, you know, in India our Neyveli and all, we have open ground mines. Open ground mines is like open space, people they dig out material. But underground mines, they'll put a shaft. So vertically they'll put a shaft, from that they'll put, because they cannot go and dig a, for example, you have a surface, say like this, for your, you know, ores will be like, you know, minerals will be there here. So if you want to dug like this, so I have a ore body like this, if you want to dug like this, the whole thing, it costs much. What they do, they don't do like that, they'll put a shaft. Like, you know, only two or three people can go inside, a big shaft over here. It will connect up to this. Then from that, they will cut over here horizontally. So that was called, underground mine. So what happened sometimes, you know, because of the rain and other things, and, you know, other part of the side, like if you have other shaft, so they have blocked some, you know, seepages. So sometimes seepages may get breached, then the water will come inside. So that time the whole water, if it go inside, then these people will get, you know, blocked during that time. So mine flooding is a major problem in many other countries. This is happening, even Thailand, some 22 people I think recently they died actually. And so biological related disasters, pest attacks, cattle, these are all secondary disasters particularly. And food poisoning, all those things. And this is very important actually. Chemical, industrial, nuclear related disaster, generally for you actually, particularly in any district, we have MAH. MAH is like major accident hazard industries are there. So if you are posted as a collector, definitely you are part of that committee. So MAH industry, there is a separate committee in a district. So every year you have to review. In your district, if there is a major accident hazard industries are there, you have to, you know, go and do the inspection over there. Because this will create a problem. Say MAH industries generally hold a bigger, you know, LPG tanks. A bigger installations like chemical tanks. So for example, Thirumala Chemicals in Vellore. So they have a, you know, bigger installation. If it is going to blast, the whole area, like, you know, the chemical material will spill over a few kilometers. So in that case, the surrounding area may get, you know, not only on-site and off-site we have to do. On-site is inside the industry. Off-site is 5 kilometers surroundings in the industry. Because a lot of schools are there, you know, nearby residential buildings are there. If a bullet is blasting. For example, there is a place called in Vellore, Rokobath. Rokobath, they have a bullet. Bullet in the sense, like, you know, you have at 1.5 lakhs, you know, ton of LPG gas cylinder. Yeah, one cylinder which have 1.5 lakhs ton. So it will fly for a few kilometers. So in case in that flow path, when they are bringing this material, if it is blasted, so how much area get impact? So is there any problem with the, you know, nearby areas, schools will get affected. If there is a chemical leakage nearby schools, villages and other things, how people get affected. So these things are comes under, you know, chemical and nuclear related disasters. There you have particularly chemical related disasters. Lot of people, they unaware because it is not, you know, not directly affecting, right? You know, sometimes, you know, people may not understand why it is happening to them. So they know about, you know, something about earthquakes, landslide, all these things. But chemical, somewhere few kilometers away, there is an industry. In that industry, there is a chemical leakage. Because of that, the village get affected. So these things people may not know. So for that, we need to analyze the disaster. Like, you know, we used to work on MH industries actually. So we do analysis for 5 kilometer radius. How, if this industry failed, so how much impact it will create. So for vulnerability analysis, hazard analysis, impact analysis, so socioeconomic analysis, everything we have to do for this. Okay. So this 5 major groups of disasters. And India is vulnerable for 57% land is vulnerable for earthquakes. Again, 68% land is vulnerable for drought. 12% land is vulnerable for floods. 8% land is vulnerable for cyclone. Apart from natural disasters, we have, you know, vulnerable for chemical, industrial disasters and man-made disasters. And these are all the maps or revised maps. So earlier we have maps. This is the earthquake hazard map of India, which is recently revised by Building Material Technology Promotion Council. It was released by our Prime Minister Narendra Modi recently. This map, earlier it was revised in 2002. So before that 2002, so now we have zone 2, zone 3 like this. This color is zone 2. This color, like, you know, the yellow color is light yellow is zone 2. Dark yellow is zone 3. And orange is zone 4. And red color is zone 5. So zone 2, 3, 4, 5. We don't have zone 1. Earlier we have zone 1. So it means zone 1 means we are free from earthquakes. But now we are not free from earthquakes. That's why we made zone 2, 3, 4, 5. So what is meant by zone 2? Zone 2 means you may expect a magnitude of 4.9. Right? It is not again a prediction. You may expect a, it's an assessment. You may expect a magnitude of 4.9. Zone 3 is you may expect a magnitude of 6.9. Zone 4, you may expect a magnitude of 7.9, up to 7.9. Zone 5 is 8 magnitude and above. So that's what the classification is meant for. This lines, you know, the major lines are the major faults. Faults are nothing but the, reactivating structures within India. Okay, and the small dots are our earthquake epicenters from the past history. Okay, this is our flood hazard map. Again, this is not properly revised. This is one mistake actually people always doing. Actually, even I wrote a comment to Government of India stating that this is not a right map actually. Because again, the recent floods, they are not updated properly, which has happened. Because every map, when you want to revise the map, you need to go for this, particularly for flood, 100 years flood you need to. What is happening in last 100? Because flood return period also, like, if you want to have effective floods, if you want to have effective rainfall, because nowadays we have climate change, right? Because of that, we are getting timely, you know, different climate condition, you know, suddenly we are getting heavy rainfall. But in nature, we have a 100 years rainfall. If you take, like, which is the highest maximum rainfall during that time, what is the flood inundation? That you have to calculate. This mistake, even urban planners are doing, they are considering only for last 20 years. That's why Chennai, we have a problem. So you need to go for 100 years floodplain. So unless you know the 100 years floodplain, you cannot go for any mitigation measures. It's not possible, right? This map is somewhat, I'm not convinced with this map. Actually, 2-3 times I wrote a mail to Government of India. So let them rectify or not. It is up to them. And another thing, like, this map is not there earlier. with Building Material Technology Promotion Council. It's a new map they introduced. This is called thunderstorm and incidents. Thunderstorm incidents, like, you know, nowadays thunderstorms are increasing because of, again, the climate change, particularly in few places. So if you say, you know, I used to, you know, monitor thunderstorms with some apps, mobile apps. So particularly in Vellore, we have, particularly in Tamil Nadu, Vellore, we have a lot of thunderstorms are happening in this place. So what is it? They put a dot, right? Vellore and this Pondicherry area, this Karaikal, Nahapattam, that area. So increasing of thunderstorms are high. So per day, you can get more than 100 or 200. So lightning and thunderstorms. So that also now they started monitoring. Government of India, they started monitoring. And this is a landslide hazard zonation map of India. So particularly in India, landslide hazards possible, mainly on hilly area. So most of our landslides is based on rainfall induced landslide, particularly in India. So when you have a heavy rainfall, there is a chances of landslides. In Tamil Nadu, we have Nilgiris, and some part of Kodaikanal we have a landslides. And I'm one of the author actually for this landslide hazard zonation atlas of India. So when it was prepared in 2002 actually. And we have wind hazard map. Again, this also Government of India, they have revised. And here we have low damage risk zone, moderate, like that they have put based on the wind direction and wind speed. They have classified the maps. So based on that, they, you know, demarcated the area, which are all, these are all hazard maps. Again, this is not a risk map. These are all hazard map. So they have assessed the area, which are all the areas is prone to particular hazard. So earthquake, landslide, flood, cyclone are available. These are all the areas are available. But you need to know what you have to do in that area. As an administrator, how effectively you can use this map. This is very important. So this map is meant for regional level, whole India. State level, you can use it. You cannot go and use for your district level. So district level site specific maps are there. I'll show you. Right, how to prepare this map, all these things. Like, you just know how to prepare all these things so that you can, when an interview comes, people, if they ask any question on like disaster management, because now all interviews in IAS interviews, they're asking about disaster management plan. It's a main question. So that will be useful for you. Okay. And another one, cyclone occurrence map. This is a new map again. Government of India, they introduced. So which are all the area they have cyclone, based on that, how many people they died, how much impact it has created.